Greetings. This video started as a refutation for argument 13. This video refutes argument number 13 from the random flood list sent by the Mohammedan. Let's look at the claim. 13. According to the Holy Bible, Satan has control over the whole world, including believers and non-believers. 1 John 5. But according to Muhammad's Quran, Satan has control over the unbelievers. Quran 16:99. First, let's see what verse in 1 John 5 is the least bit related to this. And that's pretty much where the wheels came off the bus. Actually, I read all through 1 John 5 and found nothing related to this point, which aptly demonstrates the lazy and shoddy way that Mohammedans bother to think about things. But let's look at 1 John 5 because it is deep and wide with truth. 1 John 5:1. Whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone that loveth him that begat loveth him also that is begotten of him. If you love him that begat, you will love Jesus, the begotten of the Father. The Word of God reveals that Jesus is the first begotten of God. Right off the bat, this says God begets. Jesus is the begotten of God. And even the high priest of Israel knew that to be the Christ meant a special relationship with Almighty God, the Most High. Mark 14:61. But he, Jesus, kept silent and did not answer. Again, the high priest was questioning him and saying to him, "Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?" Matthew 26:63. But Jesus remained silent. The high priest said unto him, "I charge you under oath by the living God. Tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God." The angel revealed the same. Luke 1:32. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. Luke 1:35. The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God." The demons cried out. Mark 5:7. He shouted at the top of his voice, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? In God's name, don't torture me." But I suppose if one wishes to be the devil's advocate, they might quibble that these other exclamations do not link Jesus as Messiah with being the Son of God. You are free to argue as Satan's minion if you desire. 1 John 5:2. By this we know that we love the children of God, when we love God and keep his commandments. Uh-oh! How can we love the children of God when Muhammad claimed God has no children? Let's agree to disagree with Muhammad on this one. 1 John 5:3. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. Christians, let's set aside earning salvation as a distraction for a moment. You demonstrate to God that you love him by keeping his commandments. We know that our good works are as filthy rags, but do you love your Father in heaven? Let me bring this home with an example. Christians, you know that Jesus paid the price for our sins, for our forgiveness, for our salvation. Well, Christians, if you thought about it, what if Jesus could feel the increased penalty for each sin you committed? What if each sin that you willfully commit after your salvation had an increased effect in the pain and suffering that the Lord had to bear? In your heart, can you let that sink in and then imagine intentionally causing Jesus more suffering or worse suffering? I don't mean to heap condemnation on you, but it may help bring home the impact of your decision to stand against temptation or to give in. 1 John 5:4, "For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith." Again, we see born of God presented by the message of the apostles. 1 John 5:5, "Who is he that overcometh the world, but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God?" Perhaps you did not see the linkage before, but here, in black and white, is clear mention of the belief that Jesus is the Son of God. 1 John 5:6, "This is he that came by water and blood, even Jesus Christ, not by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit that beareth witness, because the Spirit is truth." And I find this verse is amazing. What did Jesus say of the Comforter in John 14? John 14, 26, "But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance, whatsoever I have said unto you." And in John 15, "But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me." 1 John 5:6, "And it is the Spirit that beareth witness, because the Spirit is truth." John 15:26 again, "Even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me." This is so important, my friend. Let's look at these in parallel. John 15:26, 1 John 5:6, "Even the Spirit of truth," and "because the Spirit is truth, he shall testify of me, and it is the Spirit that beareth witness." There are two things the Comforter will do. He will testify of Jesus, or bear witness to Jesus, and he will be the Spirit of truth. We see here that the Holy Spirit was known to be the Comforter. The promise of the Comforter has been fulfilled at this point. 1 John 5:7, "For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. And there are three that bear witness in earth, the Spirit, and the water, and the blood, and these three agree in one." If we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater, for this is the witness of God, which he has testified of his Son. When did God witness of his Son? God witnessed by the prophets. Psalms 2:7, "I will declare the decree the Lord hath said unto me, Thou art my Son, this day have I begotten thee." So prophet David revealed the Son of God. Proverbs 34, "Who has established all the ends of the earth? What is his name, and what is his son's name, if you can tell?" So prophet Solomon revealed the Son of God. Isaiah 9:6, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." So prophet Isaiah revealed the Son of God. And God spoke from the clouds. Matthew 17:5, "While he yet spake, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice out of the cloud which said, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him." Mark 9:7, "And there was a cloud that overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud, saying, This is my beloved Son, hear him." Luke 9:35, "And there came a voice out of the cloud, saying, This is my beloved Son, hear him." If we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater. For this is the witness of God, which he has testified of his Son. So will you listen to the witness of one man alone against Almighty God? The witness of God is greater. The witness of God which he has testified of his Son. He that believeth on the Son of God has the witness in himself. He that believes not God has made him a liar, because he believes not the record that God gave of his Son. We have this witness in ourselves, because the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, lives in us. And sadly, this scripture damns all who follow Mohammedism. He that believes not God has made him a liar, because he believes not the record that God gave of his Son. I have shown you the record. Almighty God has witnessed by his prophets. And Almighty God gave personal testimony from the clouds. And if you believe Mohammed, you call God a liar. You have believed not the record that God gave of his own Son. And this is the record that God has given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that has the Son has life, and he that has not the Son of God has not life. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. Now there is more to 1 John 5, but none of it claims. According to the Holy Bible, Satan has control over the whole world, including believers and non-believers. Still, I think this video is a great exercise in understanding. If you are a Christian, keep the following in mind. We believe the witness of God, and we know who we have believed in. And if you call yourself Muslim, I have some questions for you. The Bible says you call God a liar, brother. You call God a liar by refusing to accept his witness and his testimony of his own Son. He that believes not God has made him God to be a liar, because he believes not the record that God gave of his Son. Why, brother, do you want to call God a liar? Do you think you can submit to a deity and call that God a liar, brother? I strongly urge you to repent of your folly, brother. No doubt you are sincere in your obedience to Muhammad. But the fact is, God did not send Muhammad. Muhammad calls God a liar, and Muhammad commands you to call God a liar. This has certainly not addressed argument 13, but I think it was a better message. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.